Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Alan Hardy, and Jessie has very kindly asked me to be Master of Ceremonies for this evening. Her second recital in recent times in Melbourne. She gave one last year in May, which was a very interesting programme, which took us right from the Baroque through to contemporary works. This one, as you see, is Une Nuit de Musique, a night of music, French music in particular. And it could also have been subtitled The Influence of Paul Taffanel, because Paul Taffanel, if you look at your programme, is the composer of the final piece of the concert, and he had a great influence on flute playing in the latter part of the 19th century in France, and it is an influence which still continues up to the present day. And of the six works in this program, he is involved either directly or indirectly with the composition or the composers of all of them. He's also been called, Paul Taffanel, the father of modern flute playing, because it was he that adopted the new style of instrument invented by a man called Theobald Bohm in 1847. The mechanism, which has remained virtually unchanged since the 19th century, and the instrument which we all play today. And it was he that introduced it, or was its most influential introducer into the Paris Conservatoire. And so many of these pieces are a direct result of Paul Taffanel's influence. And so we go on to the first piece, the Gaubert Ballade. Before I go any further, have you turned off your mobile phones? Jessie particularly asked me to remind you to do that. Thank you. So, on to the first piece, the Gaubert Ballade. Philippe Gaubert, he was probably the most influential pupil of Paul Taffanel, whom I've already mentioned. Philippe Gaubert, who died in 1941, he was actually the son of a cobbler, but showed great musical promise. And of all the many flautists who had a go at composing, Philippe Gaubert was probably the most inspired. And his works take us into the world of Debussy and Ravel, the world of musical impressionism. He knew these greater composers, Debussy and Ravel, and he knew how to write for the flute exquisitely. And not only was he a great composer for the flute, but he was also a fabulous flautist himself. And there are some very early recordings, right at the beginning of the era of recording in the very early 20th century, of Philippe Gaubert. And there's even a small Australian connection here in that Philippe Gaubert was asked by Dame Nellie Melba to be the flautist for her on one of her recordings when he duetted with her and she was playing Lower Here the Gentle Love. So this ballade, very free work by Philippe Gaubert, full of lots of changes of mood and harmony, was written in 1927, and he says at the top of the music, and I've just looked at the music now, and it just says, "À mes élèves," to my pupils. He was a great player, a great composer, a great conductor, and a great teacher. So, to play Philippe Gaubert Ballade, please welcome Jessie Goo and Leigh Harrold.
Thank you.
1978 in Paris, and Nadia Boulanger, Lily's elder sister, was one of the most influential composers, teachers of composing of the 20th century, and people from all over the world went to study with her, including, flautists might be interested to know, Piazzolla, our own Piazzolla, who wrote the East Barton Tango. He also went to study with Nadia Boulanger, and it was she who said, persist with your composing of the tangos. That is what you're really good at. And throughout her life, I think Nadia Boulanger secretly grieved for her young sister. Leigh Boulanger was immensely talented. Her parents were friends of the great composer Gabriel Fauré, and it was Fauré himself who discovered that Leigh Boulanger had perfect pitch when she was only two. She was a real prodigy, and she used to accompany her elder sister, Nadia, to her classes at the Paris Conservatoire. And so from an early age, she was studying the theory and composition. She also studied with the most distinguished teachers in Paris at the time, organ, piano, violin, cello, and harp. So her life was completely consumed with music. Unfortunately, her body was also consumed with illness, because when she was only two, she was diagnosed with bronchial pneumonia, and she was beset by ill health all her life, and sadly died at the age of 24. But as you can judge from this beautiful nocturne, which is to be performed either on the flute or the violin and piano, as you can judge, she was a composer of great talent and great expression. And to play this piece, please welcome back Jessie and me. whom I spoke of earlier, because the 19th century often for the flute meant a theme with, followed by lots of chirping, very busy and impossible variations with just a sort of vamping piano part. And it was fairly undignified. I mean, it's quite fun in small quantities, but a lot of it was pretty undignified. And Paul Taffanel was the person who really rescued the flute from obscurity as a serious chamber music instrument. And it's he that rediscovered the concertos by Mozart and the sonatas by J.S. Bach. And on the new instruments which were being produced by a French craftsman called Louis Lott, which are still much sought after instruments, they speak so easily and they have a certain resonance. He was able to convince composers through his own playing that the flute could be taken seriously as a chamber music instrument, like the violin. And so he convinced some of his composing friends in Paris, did Paul Taffanel, to compose some serious pieces for him. And this piece, which we're going to hear next, is the first of those series of more serious chamber music pieces for the flute and piano, which were written. It's a very influential and seminal work in the history of the flute repertoire. It was actually premiered in 1884 at a music society concert in Paris by Paul Taffanel himself, but it wasn't published until 1898. And it's pretty massive work, especially the last movement. There are four movements. Third and fourth, I think, should be particularly noted. The third, because of its beautiful expressive qualities. And the flute had not been really heard in that way before then. And then the last movement is a massive sort of tapestry of thunderous sounds on the piano and rushing around on the flute. And the last page, you're just sort of carried away by a massive wash of sound, huge chords on the piano, and cascading chromatic scales on the flute. Of course, Charles-Marie Widor himself is best known to church organists and also to wedding parties, because he wrote 10 symphonies for the organ, and the fifth of those symphonies contains the famous toccata, Widor's toccata. Those two words always go together. Widor's toccata is so often played at weddings. And I'm not going to attempt to sing it for you because it's very fast and complicated. So, please,